Leaning on the everlasting arms. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, safe and secure from all. Ooh, ooh,
Good morning, and welcome to Downtown Disciples, a progressive faith community doing justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly together. My name is Debbie Griffin. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. It is my joy and my blessing to be the pastor of this affirming, loving, justice-making community called Disciples of Christ. I want to also thank Mary Beth Martis LaCroix for the beautiful music that she provides for us. And I want to thank you for being with us in worship today, because worship is something we create together. So thank you for joining us on Zoom or Facebook Live, and for inviting us into your life and your time and your home or wherever you are worshiping with us this morning. Also want to thank G. Clegg, who's our worship leader today as well. And Rich Rosendahl, who likes to be a behind the scenes leader and volunteer. So we thank Rich as well. Today, we also will have a very special celebration in our worship, where we will have a naming celebration and affirmation ritual for Jackson Klein. So we hope that you will stay with us throughout the entire worship service today, so that you can participate with us in affirming and celebrating Jackson, and that will happen after the sermon. We also will have a time for communion during worship today. So if you'd like to gather up some bread and juice or whatever you'd like to have at your table, whether that's chocolate and tea or milk and cold pizza, just something to break bread with us together. At this time, I'm going to invite us into a moment of silence, just to rest. I don't know about you, but I think that we live very busy lives, even in the midst of pandemic and COVID. There's a lot of stress and anxiety. There's a lot of busyness in our lives. And this is a time for us to just breathe deeply, to rest in the presence of the one who loves us. Let us be still.
Let's go down to the river to pray, church. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, neighbors, let's go down. Let's go down, come on down. Oh, neighbors, let's go down, down in the river to pray. If you know it, sing along. As I went down, here we go. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, neighbors, let's go down, come on down, come on, neighbors, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, here we go. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown? Good Lord, show me the way. Oh, seekers, let's go down, come on down, oh, seekers.
Good morning. My name is G. My pronouns are he, him, and his. Please join me in the call to worship. Welcome to our community of justice and joy.
We are Downtown Disciples, a progressive faith community.
Welcome to the sacred time of resting with the divine.
We are Downtown Disciples. We celebrate diversity and affirm one another.
In this holy cyberspace, we embrace mystery and seek understanding.
We are Downtown Disciples, a movement for wholeness in this fragmented world.
Alleluia. Amen.
Amen. And now we come to a time of breaking open our lives with one another. If we were in our worship space, this would be the time that we would write our prayers, our joys, our concerns, our fears, our angers, our frustration on pieces of scrap paper, or maybe we would doodle and draw and create and color on our coloring sheets that our tables are covered with. So at this time, we invite each other to create. And even though we're not in the same room, we can still create prayer together. We believe even and especially right now, when we're not able to gather in the same room for worship, it's important that we connect with one another in this way. And by sharing our joys, our sorrows, our fears, our angers with each other in prayer, we are connecting to each other in a more intimate way. It's hard to feel close to each other when we're looking at each other on a screen. But when we share something of our lives, when we chat to G on Zoom or we chat on Facebook Live, sharing our joys and sorrows, we are in this mysterious cosmic way, connecting with each other and with this one we call God. So we're going to give you a few moments to chat your prayers. And we believe that when we do this, we open up space in our hearts and our minds and our lives so that we can be transformed by the Spirit. That when we share our fears and sorrows, we open up the opportunity for the Spirit to move in and to give us peace and strength, courage. And when we share a joy, it's so much better and bigger and more joyful when we share it with others. If we were at our worship space, the children would help us with this, and they would go around and collect our prayer offerings with their baskets. They would also collect up any financial gifts and offerings of our lives that we'd like to give to the community. So you are welcome and invited to participate with us in creating prayer and offering the work of your life so that we can continue to do justice, love, kindness, and walk humbly together here in Des Moines. Let us create prayer while we listen to the music of Mary Beth by chatting to G or chatting on Facebook Live. Sorry about that. I realized that I had something I needed in the other room. Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, such a beautiful song. It's one of my favorite church songs. Reminds me of the church I grew up in, and it reminds me of our friends at the nursing home in Floor Heights who we're not able to see right now because of COVID. So I'm so thankful for Mary Beth for sharing that song, because we often sing it out there at the nursing home. One of the ways that we can also connect during this time is if you would like to write or cards, letters to our friends at Floor Heights Nursing Home, that would be really life-giving to them. And you can get the names and addresses for doing that through our admin, Carrie, or you can contact me and I can direct you to Carrie. At this time, I'd like to speak directly to the children. And I want to remind the children and parents that we also have children's worship on Mondays at 2 o'clock on Facebook Live. So you can join us for that as well. And adults are welcome to join too. It's a nice spiritual break in your Monday afternoon at 2 o'clock. But I want to talk to the kids right now about your name. And if we were in the same room, I would have you tell me, what is your full name? Like, do you have a middle name? Do you have just a first and a last name? Do you have a nickname? I wanted to talk about how important names are, because in our story today, we hear that Jesus gets a lot of different names. He has the name Jesus, but a lot of people also call him Christ. Some people call him Lamb of God, which seems like a funny name, doesn't it? But so I put some little lambs, some little sheep, lambs on our communion table today. He's also got a name called the Word, which also seems kind of odd, but is a neat name. How would you like to be named Word? He's sometimes called and named Light, Door. What would you think if your name was Door? That would be interesting, wouldn't it? So I just want to talk about names and how important our names are. Sometimes we change our names. Sometimes people change their names when they get married. So I am married, but I did not change my name. I kept my name. So people can choose whether they want to change their name or not when they get married. And maybe you don't know that people can actually change their name when they're old enough to do that. They can legally change their name. Some people like to change their name because they maybe had a name that a lot of people recognize as, say, a girl name. And as they grow, they, as a person, they realize that their body doesn't feel like a girl and that they don't identify as a girl. And so they might want to change their name to a name that is that other people don't think of as being a girl name. And we know that some people have names that really don't show any kind of gender at all, like girl or boy, just a name. And that's great too. So names are very important because they say something about us. And maybe you don't know, but you have another name that you might not be aware of. And that, actually a couple of them. First one I want to tell you about is you have a name, it's Disciple. By being part of our faith community, that gives you the name Disciple, Downtown Disciple. And that name says that we are related to each other, that we are related to each other through Jesus, that by following his way, then we're creating a family of people who are disciples. So it's kind of like we're taking on a new name. And the other name that you have that you might not know you have is Beloved. And that's the name that God has given you. You are beloved to God. When God sees you and speaks of you and holds you in God's heart, God is calling you beloved. Will you pray with me? We're going to pray, I say, you say. So I'm going to say something to God. And when then if you agree, you say it back to God. So children of all ages, will you pray with me at home? God of many names, God of many names, we know you by your names. We know you by your names, but we know you in other ways too. We know you in other ways too. People know us by our names. People know us by our names, but they know us in other ways too. But they know us in other ways too. Help people to know us. Help people to know us by our love. By our love. Amen. Amen. Thank you for praying with me. Last week, we began the Gospel of John. We are going to, week by week, work our way through the entire Gospel of John, hearing the stories of Jesus as told to us by John. His telling about Jesus is so much different than the other gospel writers. First, because it was written much later, so people had time to think about who is this Jesus to us, right? And how do we understand him? Also, it's very different from the other gospels because at that time, the followers of Jesus began to have some disputes and arguments with other people who were not following Jesus. So There are a lot of John's language is really problematic, which we'll discuss as we go along throughout the gospel. And we want to make sure that when we are reading John and talking about John, that we are not discriminating, we are not misunderstanding John's language. So, for example, when John talks about the Jews, he's almost always talking about a few Jewish leaders who are in positions of great power and political power. He is not talking about all Jewish people. And we want to, of course, remember that Jesus is Jewish as well. So there's several things in John's gospel like that that we want to continue to remind ourselves of. And that there's some beautiful things about John's gospel in that it is poetic. It uses a lot of metaphor. And it has a universality about it that the other gospels don't have. But we have to look really closely to find it. But once we see it, then we see it everywhere. That John's gospel is really a gospel of that says God's love is for the entire world, not just people that follow Jesus, not people that just that identify as Christians, but people of all names and people of all the world. So it'll be exciting for us to work our way through the gospel of John. So we're in chapter 1, and I'm going to start at verse 29. The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was born before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here's the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher. "Where are you staying? Where do you abide?" And Jesus said to them, "Come and see." And they came and they saw where Jesus was staying, and they remained with him that day. They abided with him. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and one of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. Let us rest in that story for a moment of silence. Amen. Wednesday was for Jackson Dwayne Harrison Klein. Many, but not all of you know Jax. He's a downtown disciple who you might have met at worship or at church camp. You might know him from the times he volunteered in our nursery or with Joppa Homeless Outreach. You might remember how he and his family packed Christmas boxes one year for our Joppa homeless outreach, over 100 of them. They packed these boxes with all of the gifts and items that Joppa requested and that you donated. So you might know and remember Jax from that experience. If you're a child, you might know Jax as Jameson's big brother. Most of us know Jax as the teenage child of Laura Lee and Rachel Baker. Later in our worship, we're going to celebrate a naming and affirming ritual for Jackson, because on Wednesday, he officially changed his name to one that better describes his identity, a name he chose, Jackson Dwayne Harrison Klein. Wednesday was a big day. It was such an important day that his moms marked the occasion with a party. It was a surprise party, a birthday party of sorts, because this is, in a way, a new birth. Like all awesome parties, there were surprises, gifts, and this party included a drive-by parade. Since we are still living in pandemic, and it is important for us to maintain physical distance, it's still important for us to be safe and to not gather in big groups. Jackson's moms invited people to drive by to have a drive-by parade as a party. So perhaps some of you were in the parade and you drove by and you honked and you waved. I saw some people sticking their heads out of sunroofs, and there were signs and gifts. It was beautiful. It was life-giving. It was a great day. Some of you participated and drove by the Baker Klein home, honking and waving and celebrating this special occasion that marks Jack's identity as a male and legalizes his new name. It was a great day that marked a journey. Jax didn't wake up on Wednesday one day and just instantaneously decide to affirm his identity as a male with a new name. This has been a long journey and will continue to be a journey of claiming and living into the fullness of his identity. Naming is a big part of that journey, a journey that will include for him, I hope, a growing understanding and affirmation of the fullness of his identity as a beloved child of God and as a disciple, a follower of Jesus' way, and as a member of our progressive faith community. In our scripture story today, we're told by the gospel writer John that Jesus renames Simon. When Simon's brother brings him to Jesus, the one he calls the Messiah, Jesus looks at Simon and says, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be named Cephas or Cephas," which in the Greek is Petros, which is Peter, and means rock. Jesus looked at Simon and saw Peter. He sees the rock of the community who Peter will become. He is not yet that person fully. It's a journey for him to live into his full identity. It's a lifelong journey for Peter to live into his full identity as the rock of the community. He'll grow into that throughout time. Claiming our identity, fully living into our identity as a beloved child of God, is a journey. It is a lifelong journey. And claiming our identity, fully living into our identity as a disciple of Christ, is also a lifelong journey. It doesn't end the day that we claim it. It doesn't end the day of our baptism if we are baptized. No, baptism is just the beginning of the process, the journey of becoming someone who follows the way, the truth, the life, the justice, the peace of Jesus. It's a new birth of sorts. Jack's journey of claiming his identity and new name, and our journey of claiming our identity as disciples of Christ, as downtown disciples, is one of growing into our identity and in our understanding and knowing the identity of God. Who is God? How do we know God? How we answer those questions is intimately and intricately tied to our own identity. How we see ourselves and know ourselves is, for people of faith, all tied up with how we see and know and understand the identity of God. If we know a loving and forgiving God, then we can grow in our belief and knowledge that we are loved and we are loving, that we are forgiven and forgiving. But if the God we know is vengeful or violent or exclusive, then we might believe that we are rejected, unworthy of love, even hated. We might believe that we are affirmed in our need to exclude others, to condemn and oppress other people, and to be violent and support violence. How we know and understand God powerfully affects the way we see ourselves and the world and our neighbors. We know many queer people who have been wrongfully taught that God does not affirm them, their identity, their sexuality, their gender. Many people struggle to believe they are loved. They struggle to claim their identity as beloved children of God. They struggle with shame and fear that has been wrongfully and sinfully put upon them by the church, by bad theology, by biblically uninformed Christians. What we know about God, how we know the identity of God, is exceptionally important because it affects and is all tied up with our identity and the identity of our neighbors. What we know and experience of God and who we believe God to be can either save us from ourselves and each other. It can save us from self-loathing. It can save us from hatred and shame and fear and greed, violence, racism, sexism, xenophobia. Or how we know God, how we experience God, can condemn us to a life of sorrow, injustice, and suffering, and violence. How we know and understand God has sadly damaged people's identity, some people, so much that they commit suicide. We know many Christian people who enslaved Black people, who dehumanized Black people, indigenous people, immigrants. They justified their behavior because what they believed about the identity of God and the identity of their neighbors. They didn't truly believe what Scripture says about all people being created in the image of God. They didn't read very closely John's gospel, his universal cosmic gospel that says in its very beginning that all things came into being through Christ, through the Word of God. They didn't read closely John's universal cosmic gospel that calls Christians to love one another, to love all of their neighbors, including themselves, and to follow the liberating, affirming, empowering, Spirit-filled way of Jesus. How we know God, how we experience God, can bring peace and healing and justice, joy and new life to us and our world, or it can bring death, violence, injustice, exclusion, and oppression. The gospel writer John understands the importance of what we know and what we believe about the identity of God, the identity of ourselves as children of God, and the identity of our neighbors as children of God. It's so important to John that he names Jesus in more ways than any other biblical writer. We're only in chapter 1 of John's gospel, and already Jesus has been named the Word, the Light, Son of God, Messiah. And now in today's scripture, John the Baptist names Jesus Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Okay, it's confession time for me. Those of you who know me well know or could guess that I struggle with Lamb of God language. I've even struggled with John's entire gospel until I began to study it more closely and from the perspective of liberation theology, feminist theology, process theology, and a theology of the spirit. Seminary and continuing education and experience after seminary liberated John's gospel for me. And I've grown to love it for its cosmic, universal, poetic beauty and power. But the Lamb of God stuff was a big hurdle for me to overcome and understand, because it has been connected by Christians for centuries with atonement theories that just don't make sense to me. They don't resonate with me and what I experience in the world and what I know of God in my being. Many Christians have been taught that Jesus' death on the cross was a sacrifice that God needed or wanted in order to forgive humanity, and in order for humans to experience eternal life, the fullness of life. And for me, that God is too small. If that God needs an innocent sacrifice and suffering in order to love and forgive creation, then that God is too small for me. That God doesn't make sense with what I see of the world and what I now know of the Gospels, and especially of John's Gospel. Many Christians have been taught that Jesus' death on the cross was a sacrifice that God required. This Lamb of God language began to be connected to personal salvation and forgiveness, rather than communal salvation and forgiveness. And it began to be connected to what happens when you die, rather than how our lives can be transformed in the here and now, and how the world can be transformed when people follow the way of Jesus, the way of the Lamb of God, the way of giving of oneself to justice, to our neighbor, with good boundaries, the way that even when we suffer, that even when Jesus suffered, does not bring about more violence, retaliation, hatred, that instead brings new life, justice, and peace. The Lamb of God language that began to be understood in particular atonement theories were sacrificial and substitutionary atonement. But they're not the only ways of understanding Lamb of God language. And they're not even the only atonement theories. On close study and inspection of John's gospel, we learn there's not just one way to understand Lamb of God language. And I'm in good company with many church historians and theologians going all the way back to early Christianity, even before Abelard and his moral influence theory of atonement that says Jesus doesn't save humanity. His death doesn't save humanity because God needed a sacrifice or a substitute. No, Jesus' entire life, his death and his resurrection save us from sin because the realization of God's love that we experience in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection change us. They transform us. When we believe the truth of a God who is love and justice, then we are changed and we are saved from ourselves and from violence. When we believe in the God who is revealed to us in Jesus' life and death and resurrection, we are saved from sin because we are transformed by the Spirit of God that was present in Jesus and has been set loose in the world. It is even in us and in all of creation. When we know that God, the God who was revealed to John and his community in the flesh of Jesus, then we are changed. And the way we live in the world saves the world. Because to know the God revealed in Jesus is to be saved from the sin of oppression. It is to be saved from the sin of violence toward people and creation. It is to be saved from the sin of white privilege. It is to be saved from the sin of racism and sexism and xenophobia and transphobia, the sin of objectifying people, the sin of greed. To know God revealed in the flesh of Jesus is to be changed, transformed, saved from that sinful behavior, not because Jesus died, but because he lived a particular way, and to follow him is to also live that way, the way of the prophets, the way of Jesus. And it's also known to other people in the way of Gandhi, in the way of Buddha, in the way of Muhammad. But for John, the gospel writer, and John the baptizer, and the early Christians and Christians today, we know that God in the flesh of Jesus. And to know that God and follow Jesus' way of revealing that God has the power to save us from ourselves and the world. That's why John named Jesus, among many other names, Lamb of God. Because it's one of the many ways they experienced and came to know God in Jesus' flesh as a lamb, a suffering servant. The suffering servant described by the prophets and especially by the prophet Isaiah as one who suffers because of injustice, not because God needed that suffering. One who suffers because of what they believe. One who suffers for justice, for healing, for wholeness. Even in Jesus' suffering, God was revealed. That's why John calls him the Lamb of God. Because even in his suffering, while serving others, God was revealed. And when injustice thought that it could kill him, that essence, that word, that presence, that power, that life of God rose up and would not die and continues to live on today in Christians who believe in a God of love and justice and follow the way of Jesus and are transformed by the Spirit of God that John says comes to all people and empowers us to be children of God. The suffering on the Lamb of God was not inflicted by God, or needed or desired by God. The suffering was inflicted by humanity on the God in Jesus' flesh. Powerful people, not the Jewish people, not all people, and not God. A small group of powerful people, some of whom were Jewish religious leaders, some of whom were Roman political leaders, inflicted violence and suffering on Jesus' body, and a political system violently killed Jesus, not God. Just like humans and a political system and a policing system violently, brutally murdered George Floyd and so many other Black bodies. Now, why do I bring up George Floyd in a sermon about Lamb of God? Am I calling George Floyd Jesus? No, but I want to help us understand better what it is for Jesus to be called Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. When Jesus suffered and died, it was because humans and systems killed him. He was killed by the sin of violence and deceit and abuse of power. George Floyd and many others are also killed by the sin of violence, deceit, and abuse of power. And since George Floyd's death, people have arisen. People rose up to defeat the injustice, to lament the injustice, to heal and save our world from the sin of police violence, the sin of racism, the sin of oppression. And we are being saved. We have not fully arrived, but we are being saved because people are rising up. Now, does that mean George Floyd's death was one that God desired or needed in order to save us, in order to change the world? No. Nor does it mean God desired or needed Jesus' death to change the world. But John's community experienced in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, in Jesus' rising up, they experienced being saved from fear, being saved from retaliating with violence. They experienced being saved by being transformed by the way, the truth, and the life of Jesus that would not die. And that way does save humanity from the sin of violence and hatred and a host of other sins. The way, the word, the life, the truth, the power of God that was made known to John's community in Jesus is made known to those of us who call ourselves Christians in the way of Jesus. Had the power to save George Floyd because it's a way of nonviolence and love. It's not a way of racism, abuse, and violence. That way of God was revealed to John's community in the flesh of Jesus. It still has the power to save the world. If we would come to know that God of love and grace and justice and peace, that for us is revealed in Jesus, but for others is revealed in other ways. But when we come to know that God, that love, that essence, that cosmic spirit of God, then we and our world are saved moment by moment, day by day, system by system, dismantling by dismantling. And that one day, there won't be any more tears of mothers of Black boys brutally murdered by police. There won't be any more tears of fathers or siblings of people who have been lynched, oppressed, excluded, caged at our borders. Because to know the God that was revealed to John and his community in Jesus is to know justice. It's to know love. And it's to be transformed and changed from the inside out to participate in saving the world from violence and injustice. When we know God and when we embrace our identity as beloved, forgiven children of that God, of that love, then we are transformed and we experience new life. We are, as John said, empowered to be children of God and to live into our name of Christians, our name of disciples, our name of whole people, our name of forgiven, our name beloved. Peter got a new name when he began following Jesus. It was a name he had to learn to live into. Jax got a new name, a name he will continue to live into and in different ways all the days of his life. But ways I hope that will bring him life, joy, abundant life and joy, as Jesus hoped for all of his disciples. We too have new names. Disciple, beloved. And we too are transformed by the Spirit of Christ, empowered to experience abundant life, abundant joy, and to be saved from injustice. Amen. And now we are so blessed to be able to celebrate and share and affirm Jackson's new identity, new name. And so I'm going to invite Jackson at this time to introduce himself and to say hello to you.
Hi, I'm Jax.
Hi, Jax. I'm so glad you're here with us. And I'm so thankful that you have decided that we get to be a part of celebrating your official naming. And so we just have a ritual here to affirm you and to just let you know how happy we are for you. And community of God, I'm going to invite you to be a part of this. So there's going to be a time where I will ask you to say, "We will," and ask you to say, "Alleluia, amen." And I invite, I'm so excited. I'm losing my earbuds, and to say "Alleluia, amen" at the end. We are here to affirm the name of Jackson Dwayne Harrison Klein. We honor the names. We honor and release you from anything that would have held you back from living fully into your name. This name that you have taken is the culmination of a journey of discovery. And at the same time, it is a beginning. Jax, just as Jesus was called many names by his friends, you too have many names. Jackson, Dwayne, Harrison, Klein. You're also named beloved child of God. You're named son, brother, friend, and disciple. As your church family, your progressive faith community, we celebrate your identity. We honor the self-work, the courage, and the process of claiming your identity and your new name. In response to your official name change, we affirm our commitment to you as your faith family. Downtown Disciples, do you promise to embrace, honor, and respect Jackson's new name? Will you support him and encourage him as a sibling in Christ? Will you empower him to do justice, love, kindness, and walk humbly in his discipleship and faith and life? And will you pray for and with him? Will you learn from him? And will you encourage him to live fully into his identity as a beloved child of God? If so, congregation, please say, we will.
We will.
And I invite you to chat, we will, as well. And now let us have a prayer of blessing. Dynamic and holy God, we remember how you changed the names of Abraham and Sarah as they set out to follow you. Scripture tells us you changed the name of Jacob after a long night of wrestling with you. Jesus changed the name of Simon to Peter when he became a disciple. We now publicly declare and affirm the name that you have bestowed upon Jackson Dwayne Harrison Klein. Pour out your spirit upon him, within him and around him. May he walk in the spirit this day and always, knowing he is loved and affirmed. O God of many names, bless Jax to be a blessing. And I invite the congregation to respond by saying, Alleluia, Amen.
Alleluia. Amen.
Jax, thank you so much for sharing your life with us. Oh, and before G begins the prayers of the people, I forgot, Jax, I want you to know I have a couple of new name gifts for you. I have one of our new Downtown Disciple t-shirts for you, and it's appropriate to give you this at this occasion because this was done for us on our birthday, and your naming is kind of like a birthday. So a new birthday t-shirt for you and a... because we love you and want you to be safe and healthy, a new Love is Love face mask for you as well. So I'll connect with you on how to get those to you.
Thank you.
And you are welcome. And now I invite G to lead us in the prayers of the people.
Please join me in prayers of the people. God of love, you are more than we imagine, and yet you make yourself known. Comfort and challenge us as we open ourselves to you and one another in the mystery of prayer.
Source of joy, you name us, beloved.
Creating creator, the earth is filled with beauty. Red birds radiate with vibrant color. Fluffy clouds and blue sky inspire us to dream. Flowers and fish are as diverse as the rainbow.
Source of beauty, you name us creative.
We give thanks for refreshing rain, cool breeze, ice cream, and lemonade.
Source of life, you name us caretakers of the universe.
Water is life. For rivers, streams, oceans, bubble baths, and hot showers, we give thanks.
Source of peace, you name us beautiful.
We rejoice in Supreme Court decisions that protect water, queer people, dreamers, and democracy, for state legislation and city ordinances that protect Black lives, we give thanks and praise.
Source of justice, you name us disciples.
Holy agitator, we still have work to do. Stir within us. Give us courage, perseverance, power, and hope. Embolden us to become anti-racists. Inspire us to end poverty, homelessness, xenophobia, and pandemic.
Source of comfort, you name us healers.
Help us make wise, safe, and healthy choices to protect our bodies and our neighbors. We pray for medical professionals, researchers, healers, and decision makers. Make us comforters to all who are sick and dying.
Source of love, you name us yours.
Holy grace, we struggle to admit our need for grace. We blame systems while participating in those systems. We blame leaders, yet we elect those leaders. We blame our neighbors and those who came before us without examining our own lives, thoughts, and deeds. Convict us and transform us. Hear the good news. In Christ, we are forgiven and called to forgive. Grace is a gift that heals the world.
Hallelujah. We are loved and loving.
Let us pray for ourselves and the world. Prayers of thanksgiving for joy as John and Liz celebrate 6 years of marriage. We have prayers for a friend whose body is consumed by cancer. Prayers that his family return to him in love. Prayers of strength and courage as we continue to fight for justice in our world. May we take rest as needed and return to the work with continuing vigilance. God, in your mercy,
receive our prayer. Oh God, we pray for courage and wisdom in living in relationships with complicated humans who we love and who are flawed and invested in our systems of inequality. We pray for a country with open borders and opportunities for all, for blessings upon this community and upon Jackson. We pray for protesters who are facing charges which will impact their lives for years to come. May they receive fair justice. God, in your mercy,
receive our prayers. Prayers for my family, prayers of thanks for the pool and complex opening, and prayers to Jackson. Prayers for comfort of Naomi as she and her family mourn the death of her father. I pray for a dear friend and family as they cope with tremendous family tragedy. Thankful for good people in my life. God, in your mercy,
receive our prayer. We pray for protesters who have become the Lamb of God. We pray for immigrants and asylum seekers who have been sent away and their rights gutted during this pandemic. Oh God, we pray for all who suffer with addictions. We pray for healing for this pandemic. We pray for all who love and heal in this situation. And we pray, oh God, for our Downtown Disciple Faith community, that we would truly be your healers and your people of justice in this world. God, in your mercy,
receive our prayers. Prayers for schools and colleges as they search for how to educate students effectively and safely. Prayers for family which suffered an unexpected loss. May they all be comforted by your grace. God, in your mercy,
receive our prayers.
Together, we are the joyful justice, making body of Christ.
Alleluia. Amen. Thank you, G. At this table, we come and celebrate that we are part of a family that is as big as the world, that we are truly connected not only to each other, not only to this God that we come to know in the way and the word and the truth and the life and the justice of Jesus, but this God that we know in all of creation, that we experience in flesh. And we come as people of God who are named forgiven and forgiving, loved and loving. We remember how Jesus gathered together with people of many different names, some of whom had been renamed. We remember how he took bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said to them, "This is me, this is my flesh, this is my body, and I have given myself to you. I have suffered with and for you. I have healed you, I have challenged you, I have touched you, I have held you, I have grieved with you. And I invite you to do this too. Do this," he said. "Do this loving and serving. Do this living this way of justice and peace. Do this healing. Do this knowing that you are named loved and forgiven. And when you do, I am with you. My essence is with you. My word, my presence, my power, my life is with you. Do this and remember me." In the same way, Jesus took the cup, the fruit of the vine, the gift of the earth and creation. He gave thanks, he blessed it, and he said to them, "This cup is a new promise, poured out for forgiveness, for love, for you, for all the world. So drink of it, all of you, and know that you are loved. You are intimately connected to the God who loves you and to all of creation." And we remember in Jesus' cup, in Jesus' community, this was the cup that was saved after supper for the Christ, for the Messiah, for the one who would show them this way of justice and joy, who would embody this way and call them to live this way so that they might be saved from themselves and from violence and separation and exclusion and boundaries and borders and binaries, and they would be set free. Jesus drank of that cup, and then he gave it to all of them. Not some of them, not some of them with particular names or particular gender identities or particular ways of thinking. He gave it to all of them, as if they too could do the Messiah's work in the world, as if they too could do this saving work in the world. Let us drink of it and be refreshed and empowered to be the saving presence of God in our world. Amen. In just a moment, Mary Beth is going to bless us with music, and we invite you to feast around your table or wherever you are, and to know that even if you are physically alone, you are not alone, because we are with you. Together, we share this feast of love. Let us eat and drink.
Oh, let all who thirst, let them come to the water, and let all who have nothing, let them come to our God without money, without price. Why should you pay the price except for our God? Oh, let all who thirst, let them come to the water. And let all who have nothing, let them come to our God without money. except for our God.
Now, as we prepare to go out into the world as children of God, may we go with the power, the spirit, the love, the joy, the grace, and the justice of the one who loves us best. And may we be blessed to be a blessing. Amen. We invite you to stick around for fellowship time. Also, a quick reminder that next week we have two worship services. We have the 11 a.m., which will be on Zoom and Facebook Live, and we have a 5 p.m. drive-up church. So you can get all those details in your newsletter, or if you need more information, let me know. And now Mary Beth's going to bless us with our final song.
I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing, church. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing. And obey the Spirit of our God. Let's try that together. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says. We do that a few times, then obey the Spirit of our God. Here we go. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing and obey. And obey the Spirit of our God. How about I'm gonna work. I'm gonna work when the Spirit says work. I'm gonna work when the Spirit says work. I'm gonna work. I'm gonna work when the Spirit says work. And obey the Spirit of our God. But just as important, I'm gonna rest when the Spirit says rest. Here we go. I'm gonna rest when the Spirit says rest. I'm gonna rest when the Spirit says rest. I'm gonna rest when the Spirit says rest. Our God. I'm gonna listen when the Spirit says listen. Here we go. I'm gonna listen when the Spirit says listen. I'm gonna listen when the Spirit says listen. I'm gonna listen when the Spirit says listen. And obey the Spirit of my God. Maybe especially if I'm a privileged person, need to listen when the Spirit says listen. Sometimes we're called to speak though, so how about that? I'm gonna speak. Here we go. I'm gonna speak when the Spirit says speak. I'm gonna speak when the Spirit says speak. I'm gonna speak when the Spirit says speak. And obey the Spirit of our God. It's a tongue twister. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray. 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 And obey the Spirit of our God. I'm gonna fight. There's things to fight for, right? I'm gonna fight when the Spirit says fight. 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 And obey the Spirit of our God. I'm gonna love, church. We're gonna love. How about we're gonna love when the Spirit says? We're gonna love when the Spirit says love. We're gonna love when the Spirit says love. We're gonna love when the Spirit says love. And obey the Spirit of our God. And obey. And obey the Spirit of our God. And obey. And obey the Spirit of our God. Amen.
Amen. Hey, Mike.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. We've been here all the time, but our place is kind of messy.
Yeah, well, I can relate. We've been packing. Well, I should say my husband's been doing most of the packing, but yes, our house is a kind of a disaster area right now.
I have a good trip and safe travel.
Oh, well, we're not traveling. We're just moving.
Oh, that's right.
Hi, Holieski. Hi,
where's the puppy?
Hello, everybody.
Oh. One of us has to turn this down.
Oh, holy mackerel.
Well, Connie.
Where's your coffee?
Nice dancing, Jerry.
Well, though Debbie was doing a pretty good job, too.
Yeah, Debbie was rocking it. Hello, Lynn.
Hello.
Hello, everyone.
Where's Lynn and Bill? I know they're on their...
Hi.
Dina.
Hey. There you go. Okay.
Hello.
Hi, Jerry.
Okay,
hi, Lynn. Liz, happy anniversary.
Thank you.
Hi.
Okay, Mike, where's the puppy?
She's sleeping. You want to wake her up? I'll still wake her up. He's been playing.
Okay.
So did we say somebody has an anniversary?
Liz.
Yes, John. me and John.
Oh, great, happy John. Anniversary. That's so great.
Thank you.
Oh, there's the puppy. Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh.
So cute.
Okay.
It's that like a living... You know, teddy bear.
Oh my gosh.
Fluffy.
Oh,
hello, Princess.
I want to hug it and kiss it.
I bet you.
You should,
oh, that might be the cutest puppy I've ever seen.
Crawling on the ground outside. She growls and then attacks.
Cute. Oh, how beautiful.
Yeah, she's
okay, let's see. So how's everybody doing? Jerry and Lynn, how are you all?
Doing pretty fair. It's been a hot few days in the last few days, so
there.
But we still managed to get out and walk a half mile at a time, maybe, but we still get out and enjoy the parks.
Good.
So things are going well. So.
I'll listen in on you.
How are you, Bill and Lynn?
We're good. We're recovering from grandchildren yesterday again.
We're recovering from the neighbor's children all week.
we were outside pretty much the whole afternoon with them, and it just is so warm.
Yeah,
that it's just exhausting, really.
Yeah,
you know.
I have to stretch. Oh,
I heard that. I get exhausted just blowing up the kiddie pool and filling it up with water, and then there's all the afternoon of swimming to go.
Oh, I bet. At least it was much cooler this morning. I suppose it's probably warmed out. It feels like it's warmer now, but this morning it was really cool.
It was gorgeous. It's my favorite thing to take my coffee outside and sit in the coolness of a summer morning like that.
Me too, Sarah. Me too.
Yeah. I really love it. Communing with nature and whatnot.
Yeah. Debbie, but did you say you're moving?
Let your friends sleep through it.
Yes, we bought a house. Oh, Lynn was asking me if I said we were moving, and I said, yes, we are moving to the Drake neighborhood.
Oh, yeah.
We bought a house, which we didn't really think we would ever do again. I see that I got to do something here.